Assalamu alaikum everyone. So today we are going to start with the second chapter of the book. Let me just put my phone aside. Okay, during the lecture I will be looking at the slides. The slide will be full screen, so if you have any questions you need to speak up. Okay, I will not be able to see your messages. Okay, so let us begin. I think I'm recording this. Okay, people who cannot hear, they need to check their speaker settings. Okay, because my settings shows that my mic is working. Okay. Okay, let us begin. So this chapter is basically a revision of what you already did in Highway Engineering course, which is about road users and vehicle characteristics. So there are five components of a traffic system: road users, vehicles, streets and highways, traffic control devices, and the general environment. Road users are any human beings which are on the highway for any reason. They may be drivers, pedestrians, bicyclists, and or passengers. So you can see here passengers, the pedestrians are also there, although they are supposed to be on the side of the road, but they need to cross the highway, they need to cross the street, so they become part of the road users. Then we have vehicles, which can be private or commercial. Private vehicles are those vehicles which are under individuals' use, so they can be your cars or your bikes, motorbikes, bicycles. And commercial vehicles are either for hire, or they are
doctor.
Yes.
I'm sorry, but I don't think you're not sharing your screen.
I'm not sharing my screen. Okay,
are you supposed to, just making sure?
Yes.
Okay, cool,
thank you. Okay, I'm still on the first slide. Okay, so I was talking about the road users. So these are the road users, including anybody who even has to cross the road, like pedestrians. Then you have vehicles, private and commercial. Private vehicles are under your own use, your cars, your motorbikes, your bicycles. So you can take them and go anywhere without any fixed schedule or without any need to hire them for a specific time. And then we have commercial vehicles, which are for general use. Anybody can use them by hiring or by following their route and schedule. For example, a taxi. So taxi, anybody can use a taxi if you can hire it. Similarly, a bus. You can use a bus if you want to follow the same route and timing as the bus. Okay. Then we have streets and highways. So we have talked about different types of streets and highways in highway engineering course: arterials, collectors, and local streets. Then we have traffic control devices. I think I talked about it last time as well. But anyways, anything which is used to communicate with the drivers, that's a traffic control device. So lane markings, pavement markings, signboards, and signals, roundabouts, all of them are communicating some way of driving, some specific aspect of driving to the driver. So these are known as traffic control devices. So they are telling you how you should be driving, at what speed, in which lane, and what is your space, if you want to stop, where should you stop, and so on and so forth. So all of them are traffic control devices. So streets and highways and traffic control devices, both combinedly can be known as infrastructure. Okay, streets, highways, and traffic control devices can be part of the infrastructure of the road. And then we have the general environment, which basically is anything affecting the road but not part of these four components. Anything which affects a road or drivers or traffic, but is part of road users or vehicles and streets and highways or traffic control devices. What can be these things? They can be street lights, pedestrian bridges, sidewalks, buildings. Sometimes buildings on the side of the road affect traffic as well. Advertisement boards, trees. Okay, so obviously any of these things cannot be termed as a road user, vehicle, street, or traffic control device. So they are part of the general environment. Okay. Now from these components, we are starting with the most important one, which is driver. And as a traffic engineer, you need to have a sharp and keen understanding of the driver characteristics. Without that, you cannot manage traffic, because drivers are part of the traffic, right? Because they are handling the vehicles. So you are not understanding vehicles. Vehicles are fixed. They have fixed characteristics. But the important thing is the other drivers. How will they behave? So you need to understand their behavior in different circumstances in order to to design the traffic system or to manage the traffic system. Now, what is your responsibility as a traffic engineer with regards to drivers? Your responsibility is to provide information to the drivers in a clear, effective manner to induce or to have safe and proper response from them. So your task is to provide information to the driver, information about any traffic law, information about directions, information about lane use, anything. And that information must be provided in a clear and effective manner. What do we mean by clear? Clear means many things. Okay, it should be easily visible, should be understandable, should be something he knows. Okay. The most obvious thing is a language. Okay, for example, if you are in Bahrain, the signs can be in Arabic or English, or ideally should be in both. Okay, and you see most of the signs are in both languages, because some drivers do not understand Arabic and some of them do not understand English. But in no way you will put up a sign in French, okay, or in Italian, because nobody knows that. So a sign may be very visible, but if it is not in that language, the driver cannot understand it. So clarity is one thing is this. Another thing, again, a very easy example is for the color. Okay, so you see lane markings are white color. Why they are white color? Because it has a black background, so it's very prominent. Sometimes you would see traffic signs which are very old and the colors have faded away. So again, now it's not clear, it's not visible. Sometimes a tree has grown in front of the sign. So again, there's a problem of clarity. So you have to make sure any of these problems do not exist, do not occur, and the driver can see the sign clearly. Now, what do we mean by effectiveness? Effective manner. Effective means that you provide the device where it is required. So you will see traffic signal at the intersection. A traffic light is only at the intersection. Okay. You would see a hazard sign or a warning sign where you need to reduce the speed. Maybe there is a curve. Maybe there is a sharp turn. Maybe there is a school. Maybe there is a construction site. So you would see the warning or hazard signs only at these places. Okay. Because other places they are not required. Similarly, it also means that you provide them in such a way that the driver can, that the driver has enough time to respond to it. For example, there's a signal. You know the driver requires 15 meters to stop. That means the signal should be visible to the drivers from 50 meters at least. So if he needs to stop, he can stop. Okay, so this is also part of effectiveness. Give him enough visibility to take the appropriate action as well. okay? And we want his action to be safe and proper. Proper means, as per the traffic law, what he has to do. And safety, obviously, he has to take into consideration the other drivers and other objects on the road as well. So how do we make sure that he is learning properly? We train him. We provide information to him. And he already knows what he has to do through his training, through the licensing procedure. And, you know, he knows what he's supposed to do at the signal. He knows what he's supposed to do at the roundabout and so on. So the properness of the response comes from his training and from his knowledge. Safety and obviously proper response will be directly related to what type of information he's providing to him. Safety is something which is inherent to every human being. Every human being by instinct wants to or keeps himself or herself safe, or not just human being, any living organism wants to keep himself or herself safe. Okay, that's why you have these, you know, infections and so on, and bacteria is transferred from one part to the other part, from one human being to another human being. Okay, so it's in your nature to keep yourself safe. Sometimes information is not provided to the driver, but he is able to see the situation very clearly. So his response is automatically safe. For example, when you are traveling on a local street, you don't see many signs and symbols. Okay, even on the intersection, you don't see signals and traffic lights and roundabouts. Okay. Why? Because at those streets, the driver is driving very slow. There is not much traffic, not many pedestrians, and the road is wide. There is no problem with the sight distance. So you feel, traffic engineer, or your assumption is that the driver has a very clear idea about the situation. So he will eventually avoid the accident by himself. It's in his or her nature. Okay. Unless he want to commit suicide, which you shouldn't. It's a major sin. So you would try to keep yourself safe. Okay. So sometimes just clarifying the info, the situation is enough for the driver. Okay. Now in this process of getting the information and responding to it, there are two characteristics of the drivers which are very important to us. One, visual acuity. The other one is reaction process. Visual acuity means that it's the ability to see things. Okay, and there are many other characteristics of the drivers, but these are two most important ones, and you have them in you had them in the highway engineering book as well. So visual acuity is a very important characteristic, how you are able to see the object, and then the reaction process. Okay, reaction process is your ability to process the information. Okay, and your ability to respond to the information. Now these two characteristics overlap with each other. When you are looking at things, your mind processes them, and on the basis of that you take your action. And they are directly related to understanding of the information and taking your decision about the information. Okay, so if you are impaired in any of these characteristics, then your response will not be proper. You will have more chances of an accident. You are not thinking properly. You are not looking at something properly. You have forgotten your glasses, or your eyes are glued to your mobile phone. Okay, any of these things may result in an accident. Okay, there are other factors which are related to the driver, and that they affect his or her driving behavior and the traffic around him as well. These factors are related to his personality and psychology. Okay, his or her personality or psychology. Personality means that something which is in the background of the driver. Okay, his social background, his economical background, okay, his educational background. Okay, so for example, his experience, his education, his family background, okay, his nationality. These things can affect his driving behavior. Gender, age. Okay, these things. Psychology is your mental condition. What are you feeling at this moment? That is your psychology. So it can change your driving behavior. Okay, if you are feeling tired, you will drive differently as compared to when you are feeling fresh. Okay, for example, right now you may be feeling angry at me. If I ask if you are required to drive in this case, you will drive differently and vice versa. So your personality and psychology can also affect your driving behavior. For example, if you are an experienced driver who is fresh, you may be driving very properly and you will respond to all signs and all markings and all the information provided to you, and you will be alert, careful. But if you are a driver who is young and who is late for something, you may behave differently. You may be trying to over everybody else. You may be over speeding and so on and so forth. So these things can affect your driving behavior. But the problem with them is you cannot quantify them and you cannot consider them in your design. Okay, you cannot quantify them easily because obviously you can. How can you quantify the personality of a driver? Can you say his personality is on a scale of 1 to 10, he is 3 or 5? No. Similarly, psychology, there are so many things affecting your psychology, your mental condition. You cannot measure it. There is no scale to measure it. Okay. So, like you can measure the eyesight, like you can measure the distance and speed. You cannot measure psychology and personality. Okay. There is no scale to measure them. And secondly, there are different combinations for personality and psychology, countless combinations. Okay, you have an experienced driver who is not well educated and he is tired. You have an experienced driver who is well educated and he is tired. So they may behave differently because of their education. Okay, and similarly, you can change any of these other parameters as well. So there are so many combinations available, and they cannot be considered in your design. Okay, so you cannot quantify them and you cannot consider them in your design. So how to deal with it? How to make sure that everybody behaves in a certain manner? So for that, we have enforcement and licensing. Enforcement means enforcing the law. Okay, and licensing procedure, you know. So anybody who is on the street as a licensed driver, he has already gone through certain training and testing procedures. And through his training and testing procedure, we have developed his skill and habits for driving. Okay, the licensing procedure is supposed to develop your driving skill and habit. Okay, so you will drive in a particular manner and you will behave in a particular manner and so on and so forth. Okay, so you will not, it will become habitual for you to obey traffic laws, respond to signals, to respond to other drivers in a certain manner. Okay, so once you are in that, your personality and psychology will have less effect. Obviously, you know, if you are totally sleepy, then nobody can know what you will do. And enforcement. So even if you are not feeling like yourself, you are not feeling proper. Okay, or you are very young and so on. This is your first day after getting the license on the road. This is the first time driving alone. This is the first time you are driving with kids in your car. Okay, so even with them, then we make sure that you follow your habits. You follow what you were taught through enforcement. You get the license, not assume that okay, fine. He or she has now become an angel, and he will not make any mistakes. No, you can still make mistakes, but we will enforce your training on you. Okay, we will reinforce, that's the correct word, reinforce your training and skill onto you through law enforcement. Okay, so the science says reduce your speed. You are trained to reduce your speed in a specific manner. Okay, but if you do not follow it, then you will have fines, you will have penalties, you will have violations in your name. Okay, and now we have taken this enforcement to a new level through the point system. So you have points, and if you are involved in unsafe behavior or you are not obeying the traffic laws repetitively, then you will see the consequences in longer term as well. So you don't do something one time because you are not feeling all right, but you wanted to obey the traffic law and so on and so forth. So your penalty will be less. If you do it another time, you will get higher penalty. And if you keep on doing it, eventually they may take away your license as well. So you may have to do the licensing procedure again. So they will put you through the same process again. Why? Because your training was not good enough. Okay. So maybe the second time you will get an instructor who is not playing with his phone himself or herself. Anyways, so the enforcement of traffic laws and the licensing procedures help you behave in a certain manner, in a safe manner, irrespective of your personal and psychological condition. Okay. Now, when you are on the road, now we are talking about equity. We said two important characteristics, visual equity and reaction process. So we start with visual equity. Visual equity is your ability to see. Now you see objects your ability of looking at an object can be divided into three ranges. Okay, you can see these ranges here. This is your line of sight. The middle line is your line of sight. So it is coming directly from your pupil. And from with a reference to this line of sight, you see objects in three different ranges. The first range is acute vision, which goes up to 10 degrees from your line of sight. Okay, both sides, up to 10 degrees. So any object which is in this range is clearly visible to you with all its details. So if there is text written on the on the object, you can read it. If there's any minor detail about the object, like its distance, its size, its texture, color, everything is clearly visible to you. So we call it acute vision cone, and it is up to 10 degrees from your line of sight. Now up to 10 degrees is very clear. Okay, no problem. Then we have a bigger field of vision, which is up to 12 degrees. Okay, now you may say from 10 to 12, it is not making of a change. Okay, but it is in terms of angle. Remember, it is in terms of angle. So a change of 2 degree will result in a wider circumference of your field of vision. So 2 degree change may mean, you know, a change of 10, 20, 30 meters in terms of distance. So up to anything above 10 degrees, up to 12 degrees is called as fairly clear field of vision. And in fairly clear field of vision cone, you can see most of the details of the object. Maybe some minor details cannot be seen. For example, now you are looking at the screen, hopefully, at the screen, and you're looking at my notes or the slide. Now you can read anything on the slide. Now, if you put your phone beside the laptop screen and a message comes on the phone, don't try it, okay? You will see the message and then you will be gone. So a message comes on the phone and you can see that, okay, this message is from WhatsApp, okay? But in order to read the message, you may have to shift your line of sight because it is in your fairly clear field of vision. Okay, so you know you have a phone beside the screen, you know the message has come, but to read the full text of the message, you may need to shift your line of sight so that it comes in your directly in the middle of your line of sight. Okay, so this is fairly clear field of vision. So in fairly clear field of vision, color is very obvious, the shape, texture, most of the details are obvious. But maybe some text or maybe some minor details may not be unknown. Then we have peripheral vision. Peripheral vision goes up to 90 degrees from the line of sight on each side. So total 90 degrees on one side, 90 degrees on the other side. So it becomes 180 degrees. Okay, so up to 180 degrees. It's not the same for everybody. For some people, it is 120 degrees. For some people, it is up to 180 degrees. Okay, So anything which is in your peripheral vision, which is beyond fairly clear field of vision, but it is still up to this range, then for that object, you can detect its presence and move without any other details, without any other details. So for example, now you would be sitting in your room. So from your position, you can detect that I have a ball on my right hand side, I have a ball on my left hand side. Now, for example, on the wall on your right hand side, you have a wall clock. In order to see the timing of the wall clock, you need to change the line of sight. But to detect the wall clock, you don't need anything. So for example, on my left hand side, I have a curtain. Okay, so I can detect the curtain. Okay. Now, if my daughter comes and writes anything on the curtain, then I will not be able to see it. Okay, curtain I can see. Anything on the curtain I cannot see. Okay, and as far as my daughter is concerned, even if I shift my left eye, I cannot read it because she cannot write. So anyways, so anything which is within your peripheral vision, beyond fairly clear field of vision, you can detect the presence and the movement. So if somebody is coming from this side, from the right hand side towards me, I may be able to detect that someone is coming, but that person I don't know. I need to shift my line of sight. Okay, now what is the importance of these fields of vision for the driver? Now, traffic signs, as per their design, if they are in fairly clear vision cone, they are enough for you to understand the message given by these signs and for these markings and traffic control devices. If they are in your fairly clear vision cone, it is enough. Okay, so anything in this range of vision is enough for the drivers to understand the message given to them. Okay, for example, signal. So in a signal, what you want to know? The color. Up to this much range, color is very obvious. Okay, the speed limit sign. You see, just a number with big size. Okay, the number is in a bigger font. So again, no problem. Okay, obviously, the position of the control device will change according to your to the position of your vehicle. For example, if there's a signal here and you are driving at this point, so from this point it is straight ahead, so it may be in this range, which is enough. Obviously, when you stop beside the signal, now it is not in this range, now maybe it is in peripheral. Okay, but you have already seen the signal. Okay, so we don't mean that the traffic control device should remain in this range throughout your throughout the highway. Obviously, it is not possible. You are moving ahead, so the sign is changing its position with reference to you. But if at any point you can see the traffic marking or sign or signal or whatever the device is in this range, it is enough. Okay. Now, what is the purpose of peripheral vision? Peripheral vision helps you at the intersections. Because at intersections, people are crossing you, vehicles are crossing you, okay? And obviously, you may need to see some signal or some sign or roundabout or something like that. Peripheral vision also helps you with the speed as well, detection of speed. If you are going too fast, what will happen? The objects around you will move too fast, okay? So this is an indication for the speed. This is an indication for the speed, okay? So if the speed is good, if your speed is very high, the objects will move very fast. Okay, and you may say, okay, we can look at the speedometer, but sometimes, you know, you are looking at the road. Okay, all these fields of vision are with reference to the road. We are assuming that driver's eye is on the road. Okay, and we don't want him to shift his eyes to see something, which is important. That's why the markings and signs should be in a fairly clear field of vision, and peripheral vision is detection of speed and crossing. Okay, because we want the driver to see on the road. So in order to look at the speedometer, you will take your eyes off the road, first thing. Secondly, you cannot keep your eyes on the speedometer. You will see it once, but you every second you are changing your speed, so you cannot keep your eyes on the speedometer. It's dangerous. So you will hide about your speed from the peripheral vision. They conducted an experiment and they blinded the side windows. They put blinders on the side windows and they ask the driver about their speed without looking at the speedometer and the block, the speedometer. So they found that the drivers are having problems in judging their speed without having these the reference of the peripheral vision. Then we have perception reaction time. Perception reaction time is the time taken to complete the perception reaction process. Okay, so perception reaction process consists of four stages: detection, identification, decision, and response. Detection is what? Detecting something which requires your response or your attention. Any other vehicle in front of you, a sign on the side of the road, a marking on the pavement, okay, anything. So you detect that there is something to which I should take an action. Okay, this is detection. Then identification. Identification means that you acquire more information for that object. So you now focus. So identification is shifting your focus from the road to that object. Okay, vehicle, the sign, the marking, the signal, whatever. So you shift your focus towards that. Then you decide. So you have acquired more information. So how far is the other vehicle? Is it stopped completely, or is it slowing down, or is it changing the lane? You acquire more information. Then you decide what to do. Okay. So the vehicle in front of me has completely stopped. Should I change my lane? Should I just slow down? Should I completely brake? Okay. Should I punish him and go and crash into that vehicle? And so on and so forth. So you decide what to do. And then you do the response. Okay. So if your response was to slow down, then you would put your foot on the brake. That is your response. Sorry, the decision was to slow down, then the response would be putting your foot on the brake. If the decision was to change the lane, then the response would be to give the indicator and start moving the steering wheel. Okay. So these are the four stages which are part of perception reaction process, and the time taken to do that is called as perception reaction time. Detection. Detecting something requires your response, maybe an object on the road. Identification, what that object is, how far is it, how fast you are going. Deciding what to do, maybe to stop and respond, implementing your decision. So decision, so the response can be putting your foot on the brake. Now, how much time is taken in different conditions? There are some standards for that. Standards are given by ASHTO, American Association of State and Highway Officials. So you can see they have given different perception reaction time in different situations, starting with a normal traffic signal. So you need only 1 second to respond to a signal. If you have to stop on a highway, then you take more time, 2.5 seconds. Okay, 2.5 seconds. So you can see that the time has increased significantly. 1 second, 2.5 seconds. Okay, so this is a significant change. Now, why is that change? Why the timing on a highway is higher than a signal? Because on a signal, you stop every day. Okay, so you are expecting, and you know, you are familiar with the situation, you are familiar with the location, you are familiar with the signal lighting indications. Okay, so you know it is red, so it will turn to yellow, and then green, yellow, red. So you take less time for situations in which you for which you are familiar with. On a highway, you are not required to stop. Maybe on daily basis, there is a new check post. Maybe the car in front of you is stopped or something like that. So you need more time because you are familiar or you are not expecting this thing to happen. These things are not happening to you, with you on a regular basis. If you are stopping in an emergency situation, something which has happened unexpected, and you are trying to avoid an accident by stopping, then you need 3 seconds. Okay, on rural highway, and you need 9.1 seconds on an urban highway, urban road, for the same action. Now, what is the change between this and this? The type of road, location. So this is for a location which is not busy, which is not commercial. There is less traffic. There are less buildings and boards around the road. So you have less distractions. In an urban area, in an urban road, you have more distractions. So there, now you can see two things here. First thing is the type of situation. Okay, so signal is familiar, expected, and another highway is unexpected, so you need more time. Another factor is the type of location, which can increase the complexity by more distractions for you. So if you have more distractions on the road, that these distractions can be other vehicles, boats, buildings, trees, okay, which are normally higher in urban areas. In urban areas, there are more boards and signs and markings and vehicles and pedestrians. Okay, so if you have more things around you, more distraction, then you need more time. Okay, so you can see three times more. Okay, so this is for stopping. All of them are for stopping, and this is for doing other things in different conditions, in different locations. So stopping is relatively easier because you just push the brake and you stop. Doing other things, changing your speed, changing your direction, changing your lane, you need to handle more things in your car, you need to think more, and so on. So you need more time as well. So you can see these timings are higher than these ones, stop timings. And what is the difference between the last three rows? The difference is the location again. So the first one, rural road, suburban road, then urban road. So rural road is mostly clear, less traffic, less distractions. Suburban road has slightly higher traffic, more distractions. And urban roads, we are talking about the central area, have more distractions and higher traffic. So as the location gets more complicated, you need more time. And as you change your action, again, you need more time. So stopping requires less time, other actions require more time. Now, what do we mean by suburban? You have the boundaries of the urban area. Any road which is close to the boundary, that is a suburban area. Okay. And urban refers to the central part of the urban area. Okay, central part of the city. In that part, you will have most of the commercial activities, shopping mall, banks, and so on and so forth. So in whichever city you are living in Bahrain, you will find that there is a central part of the city, central part of this area, where there will be a big mall, there would be a hospital, most of the banks and most of the companies will have their offices there. So this is central part. As you are moving away from it, you are going towards the suburban area. And when you go out of your area, you become in the rural area. So in the central part, there are more distractions, more traffic, and so on. So you need more time. Now these values are given from ASTO, like I said, American Association of State and Highway Officials. So they have tested these things, the perception reaction time, in American condition. Now let's say you are a fresh traffic engineer and the government has given you the task to to change the design values. So you are now very aggressive and you are very you have just recently passed out, so you think you know everything. So you go and you say that we will calculate our own perception reaction time. Okay, you can do that. There are procedures to do that. ASTO has followed the same procedure and you can follow it. So for example, you measured perception reaction time for 100 drivers. Each driver, you have a new value. So you have 100 values, okay? Which value you should take for your design? You can take minimum value. So minimum value will be the best driver. Driver who does not need much time. So he will be a very young and skilled driver. Okay. But that is only one driver. All drivers are not like him. Okay. So you cannot, if you take minimum, you are highly underestimating the perception reaction. If you take the highest value, that will be the worst driver. Okay. Why should we design for the worst driver? The worst driver should be kicked out. Like I showed you previously. That's why we have licensing procedure and enforcement law enforcement. So somebody who is not fit to drive should not be on the road. Okay, so we don't take the worst driver as well. You will be highly overestimating. You can take an average. Now, average by default means what? Something in the middle. So if you are taking the middle value, you are ignoring 50% of the drivers. 50% drivers have time, perception reaction time more than that. So ignoring 50% of drivers is again dangerous. You are underestimating again. So according to ASTO, they say take the 85th value. or take the value which is which satisfies or which is enough for 85% of the drivers. They call it 85th percentile. 85th highest value or the value which satisfies 85% of the drivers. So Astro says if you are taking 100 values, take the 85th highest value. So you are ignoring now how many? 15% drivers or 15 drivers. Okay. According to them, this much is reasonable. Okay. Obviously, this is their own recommendation. You can say, okay, 85% is still very low. I will take 90th percentile. So I will only ignore 10% of drivers. Okay. You can do that. Okay. But I'm just talking about their recommendation. Okay. So their recommendation is take 85% values because the remaining 15% are very low in proportion. Obviously, 15% is very low as compared to 85%. So if you are taking care of 85%, that is enough. Okay. Only God can take care of 100% of the drivers. Okay. We cannot do it. It's not possible. So we take 85% according to H2, that is enough. But if you want to come up with your own value, it cannot be the 100th value. It cannot be the maximum value. Keep this in mind. We have to ignore some drivers because they are not fit to drive. Okay. Now I showed you for the signal, the reaction time for signal, and I told you why reaction time for signal is less, because you are familiar with the situation. It is in your expectancy. So what is my expectancy? Something which you are already expecting on the highway. Okay. So if something is according to your expectancy, you need less time, and vice versa. There are three types of expectancy of the driver: continuity, event, and temporal. Continuity means that the experiences of the immediate past or the events of the immediate past will continue in the future as well. For example, somebody driving in front of you at 80 kilometers per hour, you expect him to continue. Okay. If he breaks or even slows down suddenly, you will see a lot of accidents happening in this manner on the highways. Slowing down. Okay, they suddenly remember something, they have to change the lane or something, and the accidents happen. Okay, in fact, most of the accidents on the highways are like. Then we have event expectancy. Event is the opposite of continuity. In event expectancy, you are expecting that something which has not happened in the past will not happen now as well. For example, in your street, you know, a house is empty and nobody is living there. So when you are going in front of that house, in that villa, or in front of the garage, you are not so careful. You drive at speed because you are not expecting anyone to come out. Okay, so if suddenly somebody comes there to live and you are not aware of it, that driver may come out from his driveway. And so you need more time to think because there is something new for you, unexpected for you. So event expectancy is something which has not happened, will not happen in the future as well. And then we have temporal expectancy, which is for cyclic events, events which happen, which change according to time, like a traffic signal. And I already gave you the example of the traffic signal. So traffic signal, traffic lights change according to the order. Okay. So you have yellow, green, red, green, yellow, red, then yellow again, so on. So you know it will happen according to its order, and you don't need much time to think about it. Okay, so this is cyclic expectancy. Okay, moving on. So I will stop here because I stopped for the other section as well. Any questions? If you don't have questions, then I will go for attendance. Any questions?
Hi, Doctor.
Yeah.
Let's come back to the slide, the design value.
Which one? Is this value?
Design value, yes.
Yeah. You can see it, right?
No.
I'm sharing my screen. You cannot see it. What's your question?
Doctor, what is in a different normal stop or or highway would 2.5 second.
And the other one, avoidance maneuver, stop on a highway.
3 seconds. Yes.
This one, normal stop on a highway means the thing which happens more regularly. Okay. For example, you know, on this highway there is a check post. So it's a highway; it's not a traffic signal, but there's a check post, and you know about it. So when you get to that check post, you will take 2.5 seconds to stop. Some normal stop means something which happens regularly. I know if I come to this highway, I have to stop at this point. Maybe because of pedestrian crossing, maybe because of check post, something which is fixed. Let me say it in this manner, something which is fixed. So every time I come to this point, that thing is already there, I know, and I have to stop for that. Okay. Avoidance is something which you are doing just to avoid an accident. So it has not happened to you previously when you were at this place. Like I give the example, somebody stopping in front of you. So obviously, whenever you get to a point, whenever you get to a specific point on the highway, you will not have a vehicle stopping in front of you every time. Okay. So you need some extra time to, because the thing has happened just now. It has not happened every time in the past. Okay. So this is the you can see the event expectancy. Okay. A car has stopped in front of you, which has not happened before in the past. Yeah. Okay, so normal stop means for something which happens every time. And avoidance maneuver means something which has happened irregularly, very rarely, maybe one or twice in your whole lifetime. Okay, so you need more time for that. Okay?
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Yeah. Any other questions? Okay, so I will go for the attendance now. Again, you need to raise your hand, or you can speak if it is faster for you. You can speak up. Elizabeth, Ibrahim, let me go here. Okay, Fatma Abbas. Nadine Abdul Salam, Zainab Abdul Hadi, Zainab Abdul Hadi, okay, Ali Abdul Hussain, okay, Ali Abdullah. Okay, Hakima Abdullah. Okay, Rulwa Abdullah. Mariam Abdullah. Latifa Abdullah. Fawz Ahmed. Zainab Ahmed, Abdullah Ali, Abdullah Ali, Abdullah Ali, he was here at the start, Asil Ali. Laila Ali, Isra Ali, okay, Abdullah Ali, okay, fine. Okay, Laila Ali, Isra Ali is here, okay, Amal Fanhur, okay, Zahra Hassan, Okay, Abdul Rahman Haji. Khalid. Anam Mansoor. Ahmad Muhammad. Ahmad Muhammad. Ahmad Muhammad. Ahmad Muhammad is not here. Muhammad Muhammad. Okay, Nujood Muhammad. Okay, Muhammad Muhammad again. I think this is Muhammad Naman. Abdullah Muhyiddin. Ala Mustafa. Majd Mustafa. Majd Mustafa. Ali Noman. Ali Noman. Not here. Amna Rafiq. Amna Rafiq. Dua Salman. Dua Salman. Okay. Abu Bakr Tahir. Ali Yusuf. Okay. I will call out the absentees, and if you are from the other section, please wait. Ahmad Muhammad. Ahmad Muhammad. Majd Mustafa. Ali Noman. Ahmad Muhammad. Okay. Majd Mustafa. Noman. Amna Rafiq. Majd Mustafa. Ali Noman. Amna Rafiq. Okay. We are done. I will see you guys on when Sunday, inshallah. Anybody from other section? Anyone from other section? No? Okay. All the best.